idea.
The stars creak, I should sleep, it's keeping me awake.
It's the Sorry? House telling you oh, you're Martine? Cool. Cool. Wait. Okay, we're just sort of going over the notes. How's everybody doing? Woo! That wasn't anywhere near excited enough for this size crowd. Now, I'm not trying to force you to be more excited than you are. But, you know, you could give it one little more push while I review the thing. Let's go. How are you? There you go. All right. I've got 2 minutes to go through all this according to Olivia's notes. My name is Kevin Galligan. If you've been here before, you've seen me, whether you recognize me or not, I don't know. I run a company called Touch Lab. We make Android stuff that is, I hear is good. No, we make awesome Android stuff. We've been doing it for forever. And this is the New York Android Developers Meetup. Who has been here before? Okay, so to the newcomers, welcome. I don't really have a very concise way of doing this. I just kind of wing it. And you're going to hear this from a number of people, but I'm going to start first and say that we're hiring. And we're hiring at kind of all levels full-time. Immediately sort of mid-level, need something yesterday. But definitely some more junior folks and senior is always interesting to talk to. We'll see how that goes. And if you are a freelancer, we have an interesting project coming up, and you should talk to me immediately after this thing, and I'm sure you can convince me to buy you a drink, whether you're actually interested or not. Just letting you know. Okay, next meetup is Thursday, February 16th at American Express. It is our last meetup at American Express. And Olivia wants me to explain something to you, which I'm not sure you understand. We have stickers that are in the shape of a pizza that she forgot to bring to this meetup, but you can get them at the next one. So if that's very important to you, if that's something that's very important, they were designed by our own Liam. They're excellent. If that's something that you care enough about, then you should definitely come out. The current cohort of C4Q is here. That's Coalition for Queens. They are doing great work training folks to be great developers. I was much more involved in the first cohort. This one, I have not seen any of you folks, I think. But you're very welcome here, and you know, hope things are going good. They are always looking for volunteers and or teachers. So if you want to go out and do some good stuff, you should reach out to those folks. Okay. Where are we? Thanks to our January sponsor, Facebook, and Hui is going. It was coordinating with us, so thanks to Hui. Okay, I mean, come on, let's do a little bit. And our sponsor welcome is going to be Martine from Instagram. So let's welcome him up. Here we go.
Wow, a lot of people. Hey guys, I'm Martine, and welcome to Facebook New York. So like Kevin said, I work at Instagram. I'm an engineering manager there. I'm part of the core client org, which basically is the org that builds all the client infrastructure that supports both the Android and iOS apps. A little bit about the office. We have over 1,000 employees here, roughly half of that doing engineering work. We really, really like Android. So if you love Android as well, you know, maybe come talk to us later. Both Facebook and Instagram have a big investment on Android here at this office. In regards to infra, like I said, Instagram is doing pretty much all the client core infra work here. Facebook builds all the infrastructure that powers Newsfeed here, so that's also pretty exciting. We also have some Android release engineering work here, among others. We also have many product teams, you know, doing building some cool new products that are going to come out soon. Just to mention a few, we have teams on pages, local, media, Instagram, among others. This talk is going to be awesome. There are a few people here. There are a few Facebook employees here. We obviously really like the tech community here, and obviously we're hiring. If the Facebook employees wouldn't mind like standing up so that people get to know them. Well, we have one. Apparently we have more. Cool. All right. So we're probably going to stay here after the event hanging out. So if any of you guys have questions, want to learn more about the kind of work we do here, please don't hesitate on reaching out to us. And with that said, thank you all for coming. Thanks to the organizer for organizing this great event. And let's hear some great tech talks.
All right. Thank you. Okay, so we'll get right into it. So we got Igor coming up to talk about animations. So.
Annotations.
Annotations, sorry.
Hello? Hello?
Can you guys hear me?
Okay.
Hello, everyone. My name is Igor. I'm a software engineer at WeWork. And today, we're going to talk about annotations in Java. What are they? How can we build our own? And how can we use them in our projects? So let's get right into it. Annotations in Java. So before annotations, the only way a developer was able to actually include some sort of metadata in their program was just by leaving some sort of comments in their code or by Java doc. As you can imagine, this was a pretty inefficient way to do it, especially when you're in a bigger team. So Java decided to do something about it in 1.5. They introduced the annotations. What are the annotations? So basically, annotations are metadata for our program, for our code. And the beauty of it is they don't actually interfere with the code execution or the program itself. They're mostly there to give some sort of instruction to the compiler. We can get them at runtime too, but the really exciting and amazing parts during compile time. So Java has three built-in annotations. One of them is override. We basically override methods from our parent classes. This is good for when we, it keeps the code basically maintainable and readable, and also helps with issues down the line when someone decides to change the signature of that method. Before, this was a real issue. Now with override, the compiler kind of forces you or gives you warning at least when you do this. Next, we have deprecated. We deprecate elements in our Java code that we don't want to use them anymore. Good practice for when we use the deprecated annotation is to leave some Java doc to explain why are we deprecating this method or class, and hopefully point to the current one that we're going to use. And suppress warnings is basically just to shut up the deprecated annotations when they get too annoying. There were more annotations introduced in Java 1.6 and 1.7 and 1.8. We're just not going to talk about those guys. In Android, we can add Android-specific annotations with the Android support annotations library. Some of those annotations are the nullness annotation, where we can actually annotate a parameter in the method with null and non-null, which means that either the parameter can be null or we are not allowed to pass a null value. The beauty of this is whenever you try to pass a null value to a non-null parameter, the compiler will either issue warnings or not compile at all, depending on which IDE you're using. The next one is the resource annotations. These are great for obvious reason. Let's say you're developing a method or an API that accepts only string resources, right? So string resources in Android is basically just an integer. And theoretically, you can just pass like any random integer to that method and potentially break your app. With this annotation, if you set it to be string resources, the compiler will check for that and will start giving you complaints if you do a drawable or if you do a layout. The same goes with the drawable resources, the integer resources, and all the other ones. The thread annotations, basically what they do is allow you to annotate a method that you want to specifically work on some thread. So if you have something that you want to only run on the main thread, you annotate it with main thread. If you have some long process or like heavy computational that you don't want your app to like go ANR or like stop responding, you annotate it with worker thread, and then the compiler will actually tell the developer to use that. The integer range, basically you can set up a range constraint on your parameter. So a good example for this is, let's say you're developing like a custom view, and you're setting the opacity for this view, and obviously that range is between 0 and 255. So the developer gives you like a 300 value, then again the compiler starts complaining. There's a lot more interesting annotations in this library, and I encourage you guys to go and check it out more. But for now, let's see how can we actually build our own and start using them. So, annotations, custom annotations in our code. Basically, what they are is just an interface prefix with the at sign. As you can see in the picture above, there's not much going into it. So we have like public interface called method info, and that interface is prefix with at sign, and that's basically it, like most of it. If you notice at the top, we have four extra annotations. So let's go line by line and see what's going on there. At the top, we have the target. So the target tells the compiler where do we want to actually use that annotation. So there's several different elements in our Java code that we can use. So we can use it in package, in the type, method, constructor, field. I guess pretty much everything, every element in our Java code. So in this case, we only want to set it on a method, and the next one is the retention. The retention policy basically tells the compiler when do we actually want to use that annotation. We have three options: source, class, and runtime. Source basically tells the compiler that we're only going to use this annotation during compile time, and we just don't care about it. We're not going to put it in our .class files. We're not going to have it in runtime. We just don't care about it. The class retention policy is basically we want to keep it in our class files, but we don't care about runtime. And runtime, obviously, is like we want to keep it in runtime. And the way we can access it in runtime is through Java reflection. The documented annotation basically tells the compiler when we're creating the Java doc for a project, if some of our elements are annotated with this annotation, they'll go into the documentation. And inherited means that every class, that subclass, our annotated class, will actually inherit that annotation. Also, as you can see, we can set values, default values in our annotation, so we can set it later in the method. In the lower picture, we're actually annotating the log method with our new method info, and that gives like a little info on like who was the last person who actually messed with this method. So it just gives like a little message. And we can see that through our Java reflection, we can actually access those values in runtime for the app. So this is all cool. As we said, we can access it in runtime, but the real power comes when we actually use it during the compile stage, when we can actually generate some code and do some interesting stuff with it. Okay, so for that scenario, let's say that we have a problem, and that problem is whenever we basically code all the time, and we debug all the time, and we have to write these long log lines, annoying long lines, and obviously this is not solved by any IntelliJ plugin or any third-party library, so it's really annoying, and you have like multiple classes with a lot of fields, and it's annoying. So let's see how can we like solve this problem with annotation. So first of all, we're going to create an annotation called AwesomeLogger, which basically is going to annotate a class and take all the fields in the class and create a logger, like a custom logger just for that class. So that's why we're going to set the target as type, which means it's going to be classes and interfaces, and the retention policy is going to be source. And we're only going to need it at compile time to check which classes are annotated with this, create the helper loggers for those classes, and then we can disregard that annotation because we don't care anymore. So how do we actually like grab these classes and process them? We do this by creating our own processor, our own annotation processor, and we do this by extending the abstract processor. And this is like a little preview of the API that we get from the abstract processor. The interesting thing about the processor is that it actually runs its own Java virtual machine. So the Java C is actually picking it up, running its own Java virtual machine, and then when it's done, it's shutting it down. So in order for that processor to be picked up by the Java C, we need to actually register it. And there's two ways we can do this. One is actually put the full name in this file processor, which is located in meta inf services. And the other way is to actually annotate our class with autoservice. And autoservice is basically a third-party library made by Google. The sole purpose of that library is just to create that that file over there. The other cool thing that is here, as you can see, is that we can actually use annotations in our annotation processor. Okay, let's go through the API and see what's going on there. So first we have the init method. The init method is important because the abstract processor, the class that we're going to extend from the abstract processor has to have an empty constructor for the Java C to fire it up. So this is a good way for us to actually set up our processor, get all the important util classes that we're going to need, get the messenger. We'll see how can we use that. We get the filer, which we're actually going to use to create the generate the code. The next one is get supported source version. What this does is actually tells which is like the lowest Java version that we're going to support. Most of the time, we just want the latest supported one. But for whatever reasons, if you want to support it all the way to like 1.5, this is the place to put it. And then we get the get supported annotation types. So this is where we actually tell our processor, this is the annotations that we're going to care about in this process. And this is going to be like the com example annotation awesome logger. It's like you have to put the whole name. Great. So we pretty much have our own our processor set up. So let's see how we can actually go ahead and like start iterating those annotated elements and create some code. In the process method, we are passed the run environment object. What the run environment does, it gives us all elements annotated with our annotation, which is awesome logger in this class. So let's say we have like a few models and we've annotated those models with awesome logger, and this will give us all those classes as elements, as a collection of elements. And what we can do is like start iterating them. However, it's not that easy. We are getting all the elements, which means that we're gonna get executable elements, package elements, variable elements, type parameter elements, and all the other ones. In modern IDEs, this is not really a problem because whenever you try to annotate an element that it's not supposed to be annotated with your custom annotation, it's gonna give you a warnings. But let's say you're developing in like a text editor or like Vim or something that you want to develop in, you can easily miss this, or any like third-party developer that's using your custom annotation processor. So as we said before, we can treat the annotation processor as a separate project, so we can use Guava, we can use other dependencies. We should treat it as as a whole project. We should use architecture patterns, everything that you need. So we get all the type elements, And then we have another problem. Type elements can be classes, and type elements can be interfaces. So we really need to actually double check for the element kind. So in the for loop over there, as you see, we actually check for the class. And if it's a class, then we generate some code. If it's not a class, then we use the messenger to print like some sort of error to the developer. And the reason we use the messenger is because if we use like a regular exception, like we use in our like Android projects, since it's running its own Java virtual machine, it will just crash and it will give us like some unreadable message that nobody will interpret. That's why we use the messenger, and we return true so that the Java virtual machine will shut down properly and deliver the message to the developer. So in the bottom class, we actually improve this verification a little bit. So we check if the element kind is actually a class, and then we check if it's private, because we don't want to create loggers for private classes, because we can't really instantiate them and log them. OK. So we have pretty much everything set up now. The only thing that we have to do is actually go ahead and generate a code. For that, we're going to use Java Poet by Square. That's pretty much the standard now for creating Java files. It provides a really, really good structural API for this. As you can see in the top picture, we're creating the actual method that's going to be used for logging. So at the top, we're starting the builder. So the second line is creating a public and static void class. We're passing the parameter that we're going to actually log, and then we just add a statement. This T is going to be the log class from Android, and then here we're just going to log just as regular, like logging as we do in Android. The second picture is basically we're creating a class that's going to wrap around that static method, and we're actually adding the method. And we're pretty much done. We just build a class, and then we write that code, that file, to the disk using the file provided by us in the init method. So now all we have to do is include our project, include our compiler annotation in our project. We can do this by adding the dependencies, and the final result will look something like this. So we have our user class, and we annotate it with our awesome logger. And then we see that our processor has generated a class user_log. And in that class, we have static void user. And then the log is created with all the with all the fields that the user class has. And now all that is left to do is actually use it in our activities. And don't bother with this at all. So this is like a very, very simple example of what the annotations and annotation process can do. I'm pretty sure most of the people here have heard about Butterknife, Dagger, and all those other libraries that are using annotations and annotation processing, and how much easier have made our lives as an everyday developer. So I'm pretty sure you guys know the power of annotations. And I encourage everyone to actually look into this and see how can they actually, make it work in their, in their everyday lives. That's pretty much it. And before we finish, I just want to say besides offering beautiful spaces, we do build beautiful and awesome products for our members and for our company. We have a huge growing digital team, and we're actively hiring all kinds of engineers, and we have free beer. Thank you. Any questions? Oh yeah. So the question was testing annotation processors. So as I said, the processor is actually running its own Java virtual machine, and it should be treated as as a project, as like an app. So we should use unit testing. You can add dependencies. It should be treated literally like you're building an app.
Hey, good night. Just a little question. Yes. Is the beer unlimited?
Of course.
No, I'm just kidding. but that's great. So in your experience, when you're building a new annotation and you use a class that is in another library and that library is not there, like for example, the log class from the Android SDK, what happens if you try to use that annotation in a project that cannot resolve that dependency?
So I didn't actually show the code, but you do have to actually specify the full name, like the full path of the log class. So obviously, if it doesn't find it, it's gonna throw an error, and that's why you have the messenger, so you can like handle those kind of errors. This was a really basic example. There's a lot of interesting stuff that's going on here. There's a lot of pitfalls. There's a lot of things to consider. And yeah.
Thanks.
That's it. Okay. Thank you, everyone.
Okay. Next up, we have Hendri. He's going to be talking about offline from Instagram. Are we ready? All right, cool.
Hi, everyone. I'm Hendri. I'm a software engineer at Instagram. And today, I'm going to talk a little bit about some of the lessons that we have learned and some approaches that we have made to actually build offline mode on Instagram. So before we actually go into the talk, this is the brief overview of what we're going to talk about today. First of all, we're going to talk what is the background and what actually is the problem that we're trying to solve. What actually prompted us to even think about offline mode in the first place? And then after actually understanding about what is the background and the problem, we can see later on how offline mode actually fits as a solution in that sense. And after we are all convinced that offline mode is actually a solution, then we'll dive deeper into like the approach that we have taken to actually build offline mode on top of our current code base. Because we all know that like you're always actually trading on like a code base, and how do you actually build something new on top of it? So first of all, like what is the background? As we all know probably, like Instagram has been growing a lot since it was first actually launched. Last year, I think we actually announced that we have 600 million users. That is good, but that also means that there's a lot of assumptions actually in our app that needs to be rethinked. One of such examples is how our app is actually pretty network dependent in the first place. That actually makes sense if you think about it. If you and me today were actually to build an app that is a user, that most of the users actually in the US, it's probably fine. Like most of us here probably have data connections and all this stuff. But with knowing like Instagram has been growing so much, and I'm pretty sure that all those 600 million users doesn't only come from the US, it means that those assumptions probably doesn't make much sense anymore. For example, people in emerging markets are pretty data sensitive in the first place. So even if they have internet, they just don't have the balance to actually like browse anything at all. So, and in addition to that, even if they actually have the balance to actually browse internet, their connectivity itself might actually not be good in the first place. So it will just take them like a long time to like even like build something in the first place. So knowing that, what we wanted to achieve is that for those people who are actually from emerging markets, for those people who don't actually have data connectivity, for example, how do we actually provide still a good experience when they actually use Instagram? So comes in offline mode as a solution. It's a pretty abstract term. Some people here might be asking like, what the hell is offline mode in the first place? But the goal of offline mode is basically makes Instagram works as intended, regardless of the connectivity that you have right now. That seems pretty straightforward if we actually talk about it in like the goal sense. But in addition to that though, we also want to make sure that whatever it is that we have built on top will not actually regress in the performance that we have been serving to people who actually have those internet connection in the first place. Mostly like people in the US, for example, or people in the developed market. So now that we know what exactly is offline mode, I would actually like to show you a demo video first to see what exactly we actually can achieve throughout this effort. So this is a side-by-side comparison of what we actually have tested and built out when you don't have offline mode and you have offline mode. So these are all when you're in airplane mode, for example. So as you can see, we have more inventory to see. You can do likes even when you don't actually have connections. You will actually be told that you actually are offline, for example. You can go to like the profile that I visited before. You can do some follow actions, and we will be telling you if we are not able to like do it right now, and we will be doing it later, for example. We basically support, we are able to support like all the main tabs on Instagram. You can actually go to explore. You can go to like the activity tab. You can also like obviously go to your own profiles. And also you can go to your save feed to see like those stuff that you have saved before. So that's a lot of things that we are able to build. How do we actually approach building this in the first place is probably what is interesting about it. So before we start building any of the offline node features in the first place, what is actually more important for us is to actually sit down and say that, if we were to build this, why is this actually a good thing? Like, how do we actually measure this is actually even good for the users? Maybe people just don't care about it in the first place, right? So what is really important is to actually have a goal setting. The first thing that we do is that for every single logging events that we do, we actually attach the connection information. That actually means that we are able to splice every single top line metrics to actually know whether it's happening, whether you're online or offline, meaning that whether you have a connectivity or you don't. What does that help us with? Now, it helped us actually track our top line metric tracking. Now you can actually say that, hey, does this feature that I actually provide increase people's time spent when they don't have connectivity, for example? If they don't, why do you even bother building it in the first place, right? You can track like how many impressions they are seeing. Are they consuming your contents, for example? And the good part about adding all this information in every single event is that now every single sub-teams can have their own separate goals as well. For example, like for follows that we just see before, growth team might actually be some, the team that cares more about that, and they say that, hey, if I actually build this feature, how many offline follows do I actually get? For search, for example, if they actually build offline support, they will say that, how many search query do I actually like get if I actually like support this, right? And all this stuff can be measured. And now that we have this baseline of like measurements that we want to do, we basically think of offline node as two main features. The first feature is actually the read support of offline node. What does it actually mean? It means that we are able to cache those pages that you have seen before. For people in emerging markets, every byte actually counts. If you have actually have loaded something before and you haven't actually finished consuming it, we don't want to just throw it away. So the first thing that we do is to actually provide this read support. And it basically unlocks the consumption use case. And by consumption use case, because it's all those like feed, explore, activity, all your self profile that you can see before. Now, you might have guessed, and the second part of the support is the write support itself, meaning you are able to do actions even when you don't have connectivity. All the mechanism to actually do those follow requests, save, likes, will actually be done asynchronously once you actually have the network connections. That seems like a very straightforward thing to do, but the fact is that offline node is never something that probably you think when you actually first build out your app. So it will always be something that you build on top. Now, what is more interesting is how do we actually provide all this support on top of what Instagram is currently is already? So in order to understand that, let's assume that Instagram is has just a fragment. We have a network layer, we have a network engine. Fragment is obviously where you actually show the UI. In the network layer, we do some pre-processing of the request. We may add some like common header so that the server actually knows that it's actually from the app and all, so on and so forth. And then the network engine will be the one to actually send the HTTP request to the server. So in an ideal world, what will happen is the fragment will actually send something called a request test to the network layer. The network layer will then transform those request tasks into a HTTP request. And after receiving the HTTP request, the network engine will actually send those requests to the server, and they will get the response back in a zip version because it's a JSON. The network layer will then transform those HTTP responses to zip. They will unzip it, and they will type it into a type response and serve it to the fragment. The fragment will just use this response to actually build out the UI that you need in the fragment. Seems pretty straightforward. So why do we actually need to understand this in order to know how do we actually make read support? So what we have decided to do is we are actually introducing a response store on the networking layer. How does it actually work? It's actually pretty similar. The fragment still sends request tasks, but as you can notice, it also annotate that request task with something called cache key. We'll talk about the cache key later. Same thing will happen. Network layer will actually send the HTTP request to the network engine. Network engine will actually go to the server, and then HTTP request comes back. Now, the next part is a bit different. Instead of just serving it to the fragment, at the same time, we also try to save the zip response to the response store. So it means that every single, if you actually see, this diagram is actually pretty similar with what we have before. And the only difference is on the fragment perspective, where before they just send a request task, now they annotate it with a cache key. Pretty simple. So what does this actually help us with? You might have already guessed, but now our response store is actually full of HTTP response. And let's say that now you're offline. What will actually happen? So same thing happens. You will send a request task with the same cache key before. And then it will actually transform it to HTTP request. But what happens right now because you're offline is that the network engine will say that it fails. So instead of just saying that, hey, fragment, like, it fails, nothing I can do about it, the network layer will actually go to response store to see if there's anything matching that cache key. If there is, then it will try to fetch the response, and the response port will actually give it back as the zip response. Then the network layer will just perform the same operation as before. It will try to unzip it. It will try to type in a type response, and then it will serve it to the fragment. In this sense, you can actually see that it's actually transparent to the fragment that they don't even know whether it's coming from the network or from the cache. So in that sense, this actually helps out a lot in actually building out the read support, because there are two main observations here. The first thing is that the cache layer, which is the response store introduced in the networking layer, is actually pushed down so deep into the infrastructure that product engineers don't actually need to care anymore. What they need to do is that, so how do we actually enable offline explore, for example? What we do now is that you just go to the fragment explore, say that, hey, for this request task, can you actually save it with this cache key? The next time, if we don't have internet connection, or the connection is actually bad enough that we cannot do anything, what we will do is that we will replay those requests to you. So every time you actually do that, the fragment doesn't even know about it. The fragment just assumes that, okay, this is a response that I should actually be serving. The second observation is that by actually introducing this response store on the networking layer, we are actually able to save the response in a zip manner, because we don't actually have any assumptions of like what kind of stuff are we actually saving. We just say that whatever it is that you actually give us back from the networking engine, we'll actually save it. So these are some of the approaches that we have made to actually build out the read support for the offline node. And the next thing we're going to talk about is the write support itself. So for write support, a lot of people here are probably pretty familiar with it. It's always very hairy to actually do some retries. It's always very hairy to be able to have to like save something to the disk. We actually took a pretty pragmatic approach to actually do this, because what we want to make it as general as possible, but we also want to make it so that when someone actually needs to come to us and say that, hey, we have a new actions that we want to build, but I don't want to deal with all the hairy details. How do I do that? So what we decided to do is we have a store which will need to implement something called pending action store interface. What does the interface actually requires you to do? It needs you to tell him or her what exactly do you actually need to do to actually save. So hey, what is your model? How do you deserialize it? How do you serialize it? If I were to actually retry, how would you retry? These are the stuff that I need to know from you. Its store will then have their own like models. It's up to them how they want to actually store their model in that sense. And that's it. The hairy details of like, when should I retry? When should I start serializing all the stuff? When should I save it to the disk? When should I load it from the disk? Are all taken care of for you. You just need to tell us how do we actually, like, you don't need to worry about timing. You just need to tell us how do you actually do it. So to actually give a better illustration, let's assume that we actually make an action store. The action store obviously has like a bunch of pending actions. So what will happen here? First, after we actually have made the action store object, we'll actually register it to the manager. The manager will then now have a list of those pending stores that they will keep track of. Now, let's say that you were offline before, and then you do a bunch of actions. So we actually store them in those pending action store. the next time when you're online, the manager will be the one who actually knows that, oh, you're actually online. So it will go through every single store and tell them that, hey, you might want to actually try your actions now. And there will be it will be delegated to them to say that however you want to actually like build your model, that's up to you. Same thing for serialization. When we know that the app is backgrounded, for example, the manager will tell the store as well, hey, I think it's time for you to save before your apps actually get killed, for example. Same thing when you actually like open the app and they tell at the store that you might want to load up in the memory. And then here, when for retries, the pending action store will actually get the list of all the pending actions from like its own internal map. And then all those pending actions will be converted into a HTTP request task that we actually explain about in the RAID support. So that's basically it of how we actually build the RAID support for Instagram. And that also concludes my presentation for today. Thank you. Can you go to the mic? Do you want to go to the mic, actually?
That was very interesting, thank you. Mm-hmm. So in your example, you resort to using the store instead of the actual networking engine in instances where there is no connectivity. What strategies do you use for differentiating between no connectivity and poor connectivity?
That's a very good question, actually. So think about it this way. When we actually do in the coding perspective, it's actually really hard for us to know whether it's a poor connectivity or no connectivity. But think about it broader. In the end, does it really matter whether it's poor or not? What you want is to actually have the perceived performance of the user itself to be usable. So if you have poor connectivity, for example, you can still probably say that you can disregard that as a no connectivity level. But in terms of the RAID implementation, how we do it is that we actually have a fixed timeout saying that, hey, we will actually fire this request. If after certain seconds, the response never started, we will keep that network request running, but we'll actually serve the cache version first. That's what we will do. Does that answer your question?
And then do you then are canceling your network request after you resort to the cache?
So that's the thing that we actually don't want to do for certain reasons. For example, if you are in the poor connectivity mode that you are actually like, talking about before, you might have already downloaded 50% of them. We don't actually want to waste those bytes. So what we will do is that while we are serving the cache content, we'll also be saving those in-flight requests that might have come back while they are actually losing the cache content. So the next time when you refresh, the same thing happened, now we actually have a fresh content that can already see, which is from the previous sessions.
So you just cancel the UI update?
Right, we just actually make it so that the UI served the previous sessions, but the network request still goes.
And this part with the pending actions, that's like the store for creating UI around
right, for
like server state?
Yeah, for so follows, like, say, for example. Yeah.
Cool, thanks.
No worries.
Are you storing full res photos in the store? And if so, have you like ran into memory issues with
good
that?
Good question. So we actually took a pretty pragmatic approach when we actually do this, and it turns out pretty well for us. What we do is, first, because this is actually targeted to the emerging markets people, you don't want to really prefetch anything if you don't know that they're going to see it or not. Data is pretty precious for them. And we don't actually persist image, but we do actually use the existing image cache and video cache that we already have, meaning that if you have already seen it, you have loaded the image, we will store it in the cache. The next time it is this response loaded, we'll just look it in the cache. That means that there are cases where, like, if your response is like from like 2 months ago, those images might not be there anymore. But that's kind of the approach that we actually took.
Thank you.
Hello. Sorry if I missed this, but the heuristics around, I guess, persisting the pending actions for, mm-hmm. like, you know, power cycles and whatnot. What's your strategies for that?
Like, you mean like how do we actually do the retries and stuff?
Yeah, so specifically if a user does one of these actions while they're offline and they turn the phone off and then at some point later they turn the phone back on, mm-hmm. and now they're online now, mm-hmm. you know, the action that was, you know, encoded earlier, it's persisted correct even through like a power cycle and whatnot.
Yeah, so this is actually the task of the manager itself. The pending action store will actually just say that I know how to save and how to like load all my stuff. And we actually tried different mechanism. One of the things that we do is we probably don't want to do any, we want to do as little IO operation as possible when you're still browsing the app. So what we do is that when you actually background the app itself, we'll try to actually save all of stuff into the disk. And the next time when the app, well, now that it's saved to the disk, you don't actually care whether the app is actually killed or not. So even the power cycle doesn't matter. The next time the code start actually happens, you will actually try to load all of those from the disk to the memory again. Why do we actually want to load them eagerly? Because even, let's say that you are offline through a power cycle, we want to make sure that those likes that hasn't actually been sent to the server is actually persisted in your local state. Meaning that the next time you open your app, even if you're offline, that media that you have liked before will still remain liked. Because if it doesn't remain liked, you will think that, oh, maybe it actually didn't go through, even though it is actually there. Does that answer your question?
Thank you so much.
Cool.
Is there a reason why you're caching the actual HTTP responses instead of like deserializing it and storing that? And what's the advantages of doing that?
Yeah, that's a very good question. I actually mentioned that earlier briefly, but the reason why we actually want to have as little assumptions as possible is so that we just treat them as a string. And whatever it is that is being sent on by the server right now is already zipped in the first place. So if we actually try to deserialize and try to be smart about what is the structure of the model, we might actually be able to do some like more fancy stuff, for example. But it also means that you lose the ability to be able to like compress those responses well. And one of the constraints for people in emerging markets is not just about the neural connectivity. Sometimes their disk space itself is not that big. So you actually need to actually have the right trade-off of how you actually want to store all of those. I don't know where the guy is, but I hope to answer his questions.
What about the restore points of the application? Do you wait until the application starts, or you run a restore point every hour while in the background? Do you differentiate it between plug-in and not plug-in mode?
Sorry, can you repeat your question again?
Yeah, I'm interested to know when you use the restore point when the user is back online. So if I'm not using the application for a few hours, mm-hmm. and now my connectivity is back, but the application is not in foreground, mm-hmm. will it trigger some restore point? Do listening, constantly listening to networking event and some, I don't know,
yeah.
background
So in Android, there's broadcast receiver, obviously, that actually knows your network connectivity. There's actually a lot of ways you can actually do to retries. We actually had a lot of discussion about how should you actually retry all of this. Should you actually on retries when you actually foreground the app? Should you actually retries as soon as you have network connectivity, for example? Those are the two like main things that we have been talking about. And in the end, we decided that when the network connectivity comes back, and we actually determine that the connectivity is actually good enough for you to actually send up the like request, that's when we'll actually do it.
Okay. Is there a reason why you do IO when the app is backgrounded versus when the app is current? Like, why can't you do it in a background thread?
Oh, the reason is that there's actually really no point of doing that, because think about it this way. If the app is not actually backgrounded yet, let's say that we actually try to do the serialization. There's no guarantee that there won't be a new pending actions coming in the first place, right? So it means that if it comes in, then you'll need to do the serialization again. If it comes in again, you need to serialize it again. So instead of doing it that way, what we have decided to do is that I think when the app is backgrounded, it's a pretty good signal that there are probably no new actions that will be coming in. So,
so it's really just for batching purposes.
Right. Like, it's just more efficient that way as well, yeah.
Cool.
Yeah, so you mentioned that some people were sensitive to data storage. And so what is your eviction policy?
We do an LRU cache, basically. Yeah, we have a hard limit of like how much we can actually cache, and we actually like affect the one that is listed and recently used.
I see. And mm-hmm. do you base that limit off of like how much space they have on the device?
To be honest, I actually don't really remember the exact numbers that we are actually caching, but it's no more than like a few megabytes, I believe.
Okay.
Yeah, because the HTTP response itself is actually pretty small. What is actually large is actually the images and the videos. A few megabytes of HTTP response probably can last you pretty long. Yeah.
Cool. Thank you.
No worries. All right, cool. Thanks, guys.
Do you prefetch at all? And if so, do you do anything different based on Wi-Fi versus sort of cellular data, considering the networks that you're on?
So we are actually in a pretty early stage right now to actually support offline node. And that's actually the first thing that we decided that we don't want to do, simply because if you're serving the emerging markets people, you probably don't want to be too smart about prefetching all this stuff. You can only over prefetch. You can never under prefetch. So you actually need like some better signal to actually know what you want to fetch in the first place.
Okay, sounds good.
Cool. Thanks.
Thank you. All right. And finally, next up, we got our friend Ben coming up, visiting. Where are you? St. Louis, yes, okay. Well, welcome to Ben. He's going to talk about fingerprint authentication. Okay.
Awesome. Is there a clicker or a...
I have no idea.
Do you have the clicker?
Hendri? Is it a clicker?
Oh, sorry. Oh, yeah, no worries. Cool, thank you very much. Hi, so yeah, my name is Ben. Like I said, you know, or like Kevin said, I'm actually in from St. Louis. I am an Android developer at the New York Times for the last week and a half, actually. Before that, I was at American Express. I work on the Crossword app at the Times. So I'm also the co-organizer of the St. Louis GDG. I'm on Twitter at BenLightsToCode. The slide deck here and a example package to try out some of the code here is up pinned at the top of my Twitter feed from there. And just a general disclaimer that any opinions are my own. And also a plug, after this I have a great big swag bag from the Times of really cool stickers and notebooks and pens that are also phone stylus and fun stuff like that. So this is gonna be like a time edited version of what I gave at DroidCon New York. About how to do fingerprint, what I believe is the right way in your app. And, you know, we've seen a lot of different uses for fingerprint lately, things like logging into an app. You use it on the Play Store to make a purchase where you're going to authenticate that you're actually like the authorized owner of the phone. And so the question here is when you're doing something that's, you know, like a purchase or maybe a more secure login where you don't want to transmit a password, like how do you actually make that happen? So I guess really the crux of that is like, how do you send a successful fingerprint to your back end? You know, I can't really do this because how do you trust that? So yeah, I guess, yeah, I'm gonna send 500 pizzas to the White House and I'm gonna give a thumbs up to that with my fingerprint and there we go. So how do we do this? And so I guess we kind of want to unpack what's in the fingerprint scanner, and maybe this will give us a little bit of help. So to do this, we'll go back to the Android compatibility definition document, which is sort of the Bible written up for every Android release by Google that says what you know, requirements you have to meet in order to get Play services in the store and really be like a first-class Android device. So it says that if a device has a fingerprint reader and it has a developer-facing API, you have to meet the requirements that it has a hardware-backed key store, and it gates the usage of the keys out of that key store with the fingerprint. So what does this mean? What we know is we can create encryption keys where the key can't be used until you've scanned your finger. So if you can use the key, then you've scanned your fingerprint, and you've done it successfully. So how can we use this for authentication? One thing we can do is use the fingerprint reader to gate access to a symmetric fingerprint or a symmetric encryption key, and we'll go and take the user's password and you know, encrypt it using that key that's in the fingerprint reader, and then save that output to a shared pref somewhere. And then later on, you want to sign back in, you could go and scan your fingerprint again, unencrypt that data, send that off to the server. But you're still sending your password out in the request when you do that. So maybe that's not the best way to do it. So let's look at a different way here. So this is gonna be like, if you've ever used a public key to SSH into a server, you're gonna find this flow to be really familiar. We're gonna create a public-private key pair, and we're going to put it behind the fingerprint reader on your Android device so that you have to authenticate with the reader to use it. Now we're gonna go and register that public key along with some token so that you can associate with the user in your backend. And then finally, anytime you make a critical request, you're gonna sign in, you're gonna go and buy something, You're going to unlock a hotel room door, any of these things. You're going to sign that request with the private key that you have in backed by the fingerprinter. And so your backend verifies that the request is successfully signed by the public key that you have on record. And if you're good, then you send back whatever response you're supposed to do and you 401 otherwise. So that's kind of the gist of it at a 10,000 foot level. But let's take a look at some code and how we actually do this in Android. So there's the code here with the key pair generator to actually go ahead and create a key for the purpose of signing. And really the kicker here that's kind of important to point out with the fingerprint reader is there's this flag, a parameter here on the key gen parameter that says set user authentication required true. And what this actually gives us is we're telling, when we put this in the key store, we're saying that this key needs authentication of the fingerprint reader in order to be used. So next we have some example code of how do we sign a request. We're gonna go ahead and get our handle that key store. We're gonna go ahead and create a signature object to go and pack in some data to sign. We're gonna get a handle of the private key, and we would encode that to base64 and pass that forward to our server. This is gonna fail though, because we're not actually authenticated with the reader first. So how do we actually make that happen? So first things first, there is a use fingerprint permission you have to declare in your manifest. It's auto-granted, you don't need to actually request it with a runtime permission. It doesn't freak out the users, it doesn't show up in the Play Store listing, it's just a permission you have to declare. You also get a fingerprint manager class from Android 6 forward that you can use to query whether there are fingerprints enrolled or whether the hardware even has any fingerprint reader, period. And to make our lives easier, there's also a fingerprint manager compat that you can use, an app compat, that just no-ops all those things out for older devices. So you don't need to worry about catching some of the exceptions that would be thrown on old, or doing target API checks. You can just enjoy the no-ops and get all that stuff for free. So you can query the fingerprint manager to find out, do you have the hardware? And then also you can find out, does the user have any fingerprints enrolled at all? So you can go and say, yeah, is hardware detected and has enrolled fingerprints? And you can use that to inform you, your UI, say, hey, great, you have a fingerprint reader in your device. Would you like to go and use this fingerprint feature in the app? And then if you do find that, maybe you can go and give your user a subtle hint like, hey, if you'd enroll a fingerprint, then we could use this awesome fingerprint feature we have. So now we've got that, we actually need to talk about how do we actually authenticate with the fingerprint hardware. So let's break this down. We got a big hunk of code here. The first thing first is we take that signature object that we had from our signing example. We're gonna pass that in and create a crypto object. And that crypto object pretty much is just a wrapper for the fingerprint auth SDK so that you can pass in a signature. You can pass in a handle for, if you are gonna do public key encryption instead of signing, or you can pass in some handle here for doing symmetric encryption, decryption. But we're gonna do a signature here today. And then we're call fingerprint manager authenticate, and we're gonna pass in that crypto object and then a reference to a callback, and I'll get to the callback and what it is a little bit. There's also a cancellation signal. And this is important, you wanna retain this somewhere. This is actually a way that you can use, you can cancel the fingerprint scanning process if need be. So one thing that you wanna do is in your on pause in your activity, you go to the background, you wanna go and be a good citizen and turn off the fingerprint reader by using the cancellation signal, because you'll find yourself in a situation where you might end up swallowing those auth requests that some other app might want. So hang on to that and cancel when you pause. So now we got our callback that we had here. So we want to react to a successful authentication. So we get this on authentication succeeded here, where we get a authentication result, which then wraps that crypto object back in. And so we can unpack that signature, and we can go back to our signature method and sign that data and get that back out. Now, how do you handle errors? you got a bunch of different error conditions here. You might have, you scan the wrong finger. So that would be your on authentication failed callback here. So that would be for your UI to say, hey, fingerprint not recognized. There's also on authentication error. So if there's some unrecoverable error, like if you scan the wrong fingerprint 5 times, that's an Android hardware limitation. It's built or Android software limitation. It just locks out the reader after 5 tries. And so maybe, you know, at that point you would get a callback into here. There's also a situation where maybe you have like a dirty finger. Or it's one of the things that you can get back out of this, or you swiped too quickly. There's a on authentication help. And so that's like a soft recoverable error. And what's really cool is about all these is that there's an error string on each of these two guys here that actually gives you a string you can use in your UI. For consistency's sake, you want to use what the framework gives you. Maybe in Android 7.2, there's a new error string, and you know that resolves a different condition of the fingerprint reader. You'll be able to display that correct help text right off the bat. So this one might tell you, fingerprint swipe too quick, slow down, or you're a slob and your finger's dirty, something like that. And then this one would say, fingerprint, unable to scan, please try again, or whatever the help text is, I forget, for, a lockout condition. So in addition to implementing the on authentication succeeded in your callback, you want to go and implement these here, too. There's also a situation here called key invalidation. So for security reasons, if you enroll a new fingerprint into your phone, it will take all the old keys that were fingerprint off backed and invalidate them. Same goes if they turn off their lock screen for any reason. So at that point, then, if you try to create a signature with one of those keys, you'll get an invalid key exception. So you're going to want to handle that, and you'll need to present a message of the user to fall back to a password, kind of like this. And the reasoning behind this here is that if you add a new finger, you as a user may not want to actually grant that new person access to all the things that you had fingerprint backed. So this is a chance for you to declare fingerprint bankruptcy on your apps and re-enroll. And there is actually a flag you can do in the key pair generator on Android 7 that allows you to say, don't invalidate your keys on a new enrollment. But I can't remember off the top of my head what that was, and you're gonna have to handle this anyway because Android 6 didn't have this. So you're gonna have to take care of this and provide some kind of friendly way to sign back in with the password. Another thing here about the UI is that you might expect that there's a common UI for the fingerprint that you just get for free from Android, and that is not so. So you'll have to, the material guidelines page on the Android dev site has a great example of how to lay out a fingerprint dialog that both meets their criteria and would work well for what your app use case is. So let's go to the back end real quick. Now here's how we're gonna have to go for how to register, enroll a key, and validate it. So first things first, we're gonna go ahead and send that enrollment. This is kind of like a very contrived example of I'm logging in for the first time into my app and I want to enroll the fingerprint. So I'm gonna pass in the username for my user. I'm gonna give the password because this is the initial sign-in process. I'm going to include the public key for my key pair, and then I'm gonna sign this whole shebang so I can prove that I own the private key that I'm claiming I have. And then also there's a timestamp here, and I'm gonna get to why we have that in a couple slides. So next up, later on we can actually order a pizza with our fingerprint. And we'll go ahead and post this blob of JSON to our backend. So I'm gonna include the purchase request, and then I'm gonna have a signature for the values here. So what's kind of tricky though about signing like a blob of JSON like this is that there, it could be a non-deterministic order of fields depending on how it deserializes. So you'll probably need to normalize that data in some fashion. So, whatever works for you. One thing I did in the example, and I've, whoop, I've done in other apps is just kind of concatenate it into one blob of string separated by pipes, and then sign that. And then the back end will need to go and do the same to unpack it. So that we, you know, these strings match, you're signing, you're verifying the signature against that the same way that you normalized it on the client side. However you choose to do this, you've got to create that normalized version of it on the client the same way that you do on the server. Otherwise, the signatures won't validate. So now let's go back to why we had that timestamp. What you want to do is use something they call a nonce, if you've not heard of that before. The idea here is we want to include some piece of data to keep us from reposting that same same request, going back and ordering another set of 500 pizzas to the White House. So for instance, a timestamp might prevent you from replaying that because you know you could have a validity window around the request. And if I replay that, you know, an hour later, we could send back an error saying, you know, a timestamp is no good. If you try and monkey with that timestamp to pass the validation period, then the signature won't validate anymore. So you're either valid on timestamp or you're valid on signature, or invalid on timestamp or invalid on signature when you try and tamper with it. So you could also use some other business data that you have. Maybe when you generate an order for your pizza, you generate a UUID client side for that pizza order. You could go and check your back end to see, hey, is this UUID already been used? Whatever works in your business case, maybe a timestamp works great. And then also, as any Android presentation goes, there's always a shout out to Samsung. Things we found here. If you claim you have fingerprint in your app, you're probably gonna end up getting some like 1 and 2 star reviews from users who say, I've got a Galaxy S5 or a Note 4 that has a fingerprint reader, but I can't actually use it in your app. And the problem is that those phones actually just have a fingerprint API that is not compatible with the Android CDD compliant API because Samsung. And what it actually just does is it does a callback to say, hey, fingerprint, good work. So we're back where we were on slide one. So you can't really do much with that, unfortunately. So when you try and use the hardware detection method on the fingerprint manager, you're gonna get back false because while you have hardware, it's not good hardware. Another thing we found the hard way is that on some Samsung devices, when you don't have a fingerprint enrolled at all, like in the settings, you call has enrolled fingerprints, instead of getting false, you get back a security exception, because why not? You gotta catch that. It's a runtime exception, you gotta catch it, and just treat it as though it's false. So definitely those are things that found out the hard way that you don't have to learn the hard way anymore. I've got an example app here of all of this, and actually the unedited presentation from DroidCon. It's also the same thing posted at the top of my Twitter right now at BenLightsToCode, or here is a link to my GitHub, OQTMGF. but this is a link to GitHub repo with a sample backend that you can just run locally, and then run it alongside your emulator and see how it plays out, and look at like validation and registration and some example UI on how to do the interactions between the fingerprint SDK and how you should actually make it work for your user. So with that, I thank you all very much and open the floor for questions. And yeah, see me later. I got lots of sweat.
All right. Thanks again. Let's hear it for all of our speakers. Wonderful content. All right. So we got some closing announcements. First off, I want to thank Olivia, who does all this wonderful work. Say hello to Olivia. Yeah, I for the last year, I pretty much just got up here and read her notes. I really don't do anything anymore, just in case you're wondering. And as a reminder, we are hiring. I do that. So, and we do actually make awesome stuff, so don't forget that, and we're hiring. Okay, so see you at our next meetup. It's going to be great. Thanks again to Facebook, especially Hui, for coordinating. And very important, if you are sort of the Night Owl persuasion, we have the after party at Central Bar, which is one block east. So go there. And I guess that's it. And try to help our host by taking whatever garbage you may have created in your space with you towards the back. All right. See you in a month. Bye, guys. Gonna get through-